I value the importance of being honest, and to be honest with you, I screwed up my first class pretty badly. Okay, so I was very stressed with moving to another country. I went to Hong Kong for first job. Everything was difficult. There was a lot of work, children, everything together. So anyway, so I wanted to make it for you much easier if you just listen to a couple advices. So just bear with me. Ask me any questions. So here we go. So very likely, I have a lot of doctoral students, very likely your first class is going to be failure. And why, believe it or not, in one way or another, you will see how difficult this would be. Something will go wrong. Okay. So in the end, you will recover. You will make sure that everything's fine, but all of this will come at the cost of spending much more time, of stress, of not doing research. And then in the end, you'll be thinking like, was it worth it? What did I do wrong? So I'm going to talk about common misconceptions, about mistakes that I made and my colleagues made. So I just kind of put them together in a list, and about a couple tricks that can help you to teach. And feel free to ask me whatever you want at the end. Okay. All right. Misconceptions from what I know. One, it's very difficult to teach in English because you are a foreign student. But guys, look around you in the PhD program, or look around at your colleagues. Many of your colleagues, many of your fellow PhD students are also foreigners. They don't speak perfect English and they still get by fine. So there is some correlation, yes, but it's not crucial. Okay. Second, there are wrong classes and there are right classes. The wrong classes would be some executive MBA or MBA classes or some more technical classes. Evening especially sometimes can be difficult because students are cranky. This is true, but your department chair usually knows about this. They usually would not assign you the class that would be too difficult for you to teach. And you can teach this class differently. So if you teach evening class, for example, you can adjust in a way that's more understandable and more flexible for them. Okay, got it? And sometimes my students say, well, you can teach anything. You just have to teach very simple stuff. Don't make it complicated. Just make a simple lecture. Don't push too much. That's true, but it only works in the short term. Students, after a couple lectures, they expect that you're going to teach only simple stuff, nothing else. They also you would be kind of appealing. Your teaching would be appealing to students who don't want to learn, but to the students who are really eager to learn, this would not be appealing too much. So there is a balance. Okay. So what works? What does not work? The most important part, the very most important part in teaching, like everyone says, is organization. And this is because teaching is not given lecture, right? Like giving a lecture is just some part of it. Teaching is a managing of the class. And there are a lot of aspects in managing of the class. You have to, like imagine you're going to present today, the lecture. You have to make sure that you have lecture notes. You have to post this lecture note somewhere on Canvas. You have to print some handouts if there are handouts. You have to prepare some survey. You have to talk to your teaching assistant if there is one, right? You have to think about the textbook or the software that comes with textbook that might not work. You have to check with students. You have to reply the emails and so on and so on and so forth. So there are many, many things. As soon as students feel that you are not in charge, you're not kind of following on all of these issues in time, then they will think the class is disorganized and they don't need to do their part. They don't need to attend class. They don't need to do their homework. They have to feel that you're in charge and everything is done correctly. Okay? So related to this is consistency of the class. And maybe I'll go by example. So suppose you're teaching a relatively difficult class and a couple students come up to you at the end of the class and say, well, this class is just a little bit too difficult for us. We're just not following. So of course, you'd have to adjust this class a little. But what I saw in the past is that my colleagues would start adjusting class drastically. They would start changing textbook even, topics. They cut out, for example, they say in the beginning they're going to teach, say, some part from asset pricing, and then they completely remove it because it's just too long. And they start repeating the previous material. This is no, because students get confused. So if you promise to teach this material, you have to teach and just adjust it slowly downward and work more with the students to make sure that they catch up. Okay, what else works? Use some technology, especially recently. If you work on Zoom or if you have some hybrid type of approach to the class, you can do polls on Zoom. and people, students really appreciate it. You can split up the class, especially if it's a long class, give them in the middle of the class some small assignment to do so that they feel this assignment, because that gives you time kind of to recuperate and think about what next you have to teach. And it gives students kind of something to catch up with. Okay. I saw people recently using Kahoot games in classes. It's a very silly thing, but it's kind of entertainment, and students appreciate that you take 5 minutes of the serious class. And okay, team competitions, split them sometimes, not always, sometimes in team, and organize a competition between teams. Or if you decide who's presenting, run a lottery so that they select like first number, second number, and then you eventually decide what person would be presenting. So make it interesting in some way. Tricks. So in Hong Kong, I remember the senior professor says, well, you're not using hooks in your lecture. I'm like, what are hooks? So hooks, informal word, apparently it's something that have to catch attention. Let me go by example. Suppose you're teaching an undergraduate class. An undergraduate class is going to be about IPO. The students don't even know what initial public offering is. Okay, instead of explaining in the beginning, I'm going to teach you about IPOs. No, you start with like, look, guys, we are in Hong Kong, for example, and the IPO in Hong Kong on the first day earns 18% on average. So if you invest like every week into IPOs, by the end of the year, you should have 10 times the amount that you initially had. And then the students become interested, and you have to explain to them, first of all, what IPO is, and second, why in reality you cannot make 10 times the amount of money if you invest in actual IPO, even if average IPO increases by 18% the stock price. Okay? So the next one, take with a grain of salt. This is very sinister suggestion, but I kind of tried it once and I saw people using it a lot. So suppose you're teaching derivatives or some maybe Python programming or something, and you notice that people in your class are not prepared in general. So you look kind of at their background and you're thinking like many of them will not handle. Well, one of the kind of terrible way, but effective way would be to give very difficult first class. Remember, during the first and second class, they still can drop the class. So the people who you start, for example, the derivatives with the ordinary and second order differential and partial differential equations. And if you spend like first an hour on this, no, don't do it too much. Then eventually you'll see the people drop out because it's just like there's no way I'm going to handle this. And you will have maybe 80% of the class, but people who are really willing to go through. Okay. Very important. Ask for feedback. Also learn the hard way. After first or second class, give them some maybe piece of paper so they cannot avoid it, and ask them to write what positive and negative suggestions they have for you, like make it anonymous. And not only that, follow up on any suggestions that they give. Anything they tell you, come to the next class and discuss. Like, for example, you asked me to include a topic on particular derivatives. I'm including it in the class. So just make them feel that their questions were addressed. No questions? All right. Never, 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 ever do the following. And I put it here briefly. Never run the class late. So as a professor, you think, what a big deal. I still have 10 slides. Let me just do another 10 minutes. Students hate it. And to understand that they hate it, remember yourself like 10 years earlier, somewhere in undergraduate degree. You'd never like the professor like run the class late. They need to go somewhere else. Don't give them printed notes for everything, like some of my colleagues. If you start giving them notes every time, they will demand notes every time, and they don't make their own notes ever. So just figure out how much is necessary. Do not, this is absolutely no. Do not teach without any notes. So unless you are genius. So I've seen people, especially teaching assistants, they come and they think, okay, well, I understand some capital structure, I'll tell you. And they start writing on the board. That's terrible, because unless you're absolutely genius, and there are some people who can prepare mentally, you need to look back at your notes and remember what you wanted to say and write down, because under stress, you wouldn't be able to write it correctly. Do not ignore any questions from audience, just as in research seminars. They ask you, at least answer something. At least tell them like, okay, you asked me the question, I don't know the answer yet, but I'll write it down, I'll get back to you. Never not ask any questions. So students will, especially the undergraduate students, I sometimes sit back for evaluation of my colleagues on the back of the class, and I see how they like do shopping on their computers during the lecture. So they are distracted. Make sure that they're involved. When I teach, I ask them questions constantly. They hate me for this maybe first two lectures, but then they can become more and more okay. I ask them, like, I remember names and I ask them one by one, like, tell me the answer to this question. Did you understand this? Can you answer that? So that keeps them involved and makes in the long term your job easier. Some of my colleagues, I remember, were given lectures to teaching assistants or somebody to teach, or cancel the lectures. No. So you will run in trouble sooner or later. So there are some emergencies, but aside from this, don't do it. And helping too much on the homework, this is kind of balance. You have to make them feel that they helped in some, just push them in the right direction. But if you start writing solutions for them, they will come each time and ask for solutions. Okay, fair enough. All right. So common problems and common solutions. Bad apple situation. Seen it many times. So let me describe you an example. So big class, 60 or 70 people. You start noticing that somewhere, I've seen it once and I fix it very quickly, but I've seen it in other classes. You suddenly notice that a couple of people just talk to each other about your class and then kind of come to you and start asking, like, is this class going to be like this? Can you change something? So what you have to understand is there are maybe one or two very smart students, three, they decide that your class is either too easy or too difficult or too specific. They talk to each other and then they go and talk to everyone. So it spreads like a disease. So what you want to do is you want to figure out kind of these people, and you want to talk to them, and you want to address what the issue is. So sometimes it is just misunderstanding. Don't wait too long. Use the feedback, for example. Okay. This happens to everyone. You start, second one, coordination with the other classes. You start teaching class, especially the core classes, like corporate finance, for example, or asset management. You start and you realize that there was another class before you and you didn't check what was in this class. You may be teaching exactly the same thing, that's not interesting, or you may be teaching like skipping three topics in between. So do your homework, check just a little bit to see what was taught before. How does it fall in the whole class? Students use electronics. Now it's getting worse and worse and worse now, even in my memory. So I don't know what to do. What I do is I don't give them specific restrictions, but I call them constantly. So I see if the person is looking in the phone, and it's very easy to see, then I just call him constantly. So like after two lectures, he realizes maybe it's not a good idea to look in the phone all the time. Students will come and ask you to reconsider grades. So this is very delicate thing. So when you kind of want to change the grades, obviously if it's incorrect, you kind of want to help if they just come and they want to understand, or you give them something, okay? So they came, they understood the issues, like, it's okay to give them extra credit. But if you change the grade, if they just come complain and you worry about evaluations and you change the grade to perfect grade, then you're going to have many more problems later on. Okay. So we mentioned, Aidan mentioned teaching versus research, big topic. So what do you do as a first year professor about your teaching and research? A big surprise to me, was that people who are kind of more seasoned, they say they do more research when they're teaching because they're more. And in other semesters, they just take it easier. So it's not clear whether there is trade-off. Okay. Second, in most schools, where you're going to go, there is an emphasis on research and there is a requirement for teaching. I prefer to think about this from like doctoral admissions for foreign students, and many of us are foreign students. There is a TOEFL requirement, right? And there is a like GRE and grade requirement. So when you apply to good schools, you want to keep your TOEFL at some minimum. You want to have it good, right? But not necessarily like 100%. But some GRE or GMAT, you want to have at 100%. So same thing about research. Research has to be very, very good because that's what gets noticed. And teaching has to be at least at certain level. So don't kind of jeopardize this level. It's good to concentrate all teaching, and that depends on your school. It's good to concentrate teaching in one semester. So don't hesitate. Once you get your job, ask whether you can teach everything in one semester, because that kind of takes it off the table, gets all stressed into one semester, and then you're done. Especially if you can do it like in some weeks, it's even perfect, even better. And then you can do research. So that's usually better, but it depends. Okay. So that's about all I wanted to share, and I'm happy to answer questions. I wanted to emphasize a couple things. Expect, as was already mentioned, expect to spend a lot of time in your first class, because the more time you spend in the first semester, the less time you need later on. So do the prep. Most of these problems can be avoided if you simply prepare it. So just take some time week before, organize everything, organize syllabus, organize all notes, write down the list what you have to do. And there will be a lot, believe me, there will be a lot of things to remember. And if you are still in a graduate school, then ask to teach an independent class. Teach one class yourself. This, as a warning, this will not give you the full exposure to teaching because it's still kind of not completely independent teaching, but it will give you a very good idea of how to handle class. Okay? That's all I had. And if you have any questions, I can answer.